Good morning. Welcome to the last day of the church year. And our specific theme for this morning is Scripture produces certainty for the waiting. As we take a look at the second lesson for today from the last chapter of Scripture, Revelation chapter 22, we're going to be stressing the fact that we need to pay close attention to God's Word, to His truth. Because it is in that word that we find our hope, our direction, and those who hold to the truth of Scripture will be the ones who share in the blessings that we find described for us in the book of Revelation. So with those thoughts in mind, we bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, today as we have gathered for worship on this last Sunday of the church year, we thank you for this past church year and our opportunity to meditate upon your word, to gain insight and wisdom. We pray today that that same insight and wisdom will be produced in us as well, that we might find great certainty for that day when you will return again in all your glory. Bless our time together today as we ask these things in our Savior's name. Amen. Today's worship begins with hymn 360, Behold the Branches Growing. Please rise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children. But we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Let us pray. Eternal God, merciful Father, you have appointed your Son as judge of the living and the dead. Enable us to wait for the day of his return with our eyes fixed on the kingdom prepared for your own from the foundation of the world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. Our readings for today are the readings for the last Sunday of the church year. And for our first lesson, we turn to the book of the prophet Habakkuk. We read from chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, and then chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, stressing the aspect we need to be watching. The threatening oracle which the prophet Habakkuk saw. How long, Lord, must I cry for help? But you do not listen. I call out to you violence, but you do not save. Why do you cause me to see injustice? Why do you overlook misery? Devastation and violence confront me. There is strife and tensions rise. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the city wall. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer he will give to my complaint. Then the Lord answered me. He said, record the vision and write it plainly on tablets so that a herald may run with it. Indeed, the vision is waiting for the appointed time. It longs for fulfillment and will not prove false. If it seems slow in coming, wait for it. Because it will certainly come and will not be delayed. Look, his soul is puffed up and is not righteous within him, but the righteous one will live by his faith. Here ends our first scripture lesson. Today's psalm is Psalm 130a. This morning we will join in singing the psalm together.
Of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. How out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Listen closely as I call on you for help. Lord, if you kept track of sins, O Lord, then who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. More than watchers wait for morning, my soul waits for the Lord. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is faithful love. With him is complete redemption. He will redeem Israel from the guilt of their sins. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice.
Our second lesson, which serves as our sermon text for today, comes from the last chapter of Scripture, Revelation 22. We begin reading at verse 6. The angel said to me, "These words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place. And look, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who holds on to the words of the prophecy of this book. I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. When I heard and saw them, I bowed down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed me these things. But he said to me, 'Do not do it. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers, the prophets, and also with those who hold on to the words of this book. Worship God.' The angel also said to me, 'Do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, because the time is near. Let the one who is unjust continue to be unjust. Let the one who is filthy continue to be filthy. Let the one who is just continue to do what is just. Let the one who is holy continue to be holy. Look, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me, to repay each one according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." Here ends our second lesson. Alleluia. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. Alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. These words are written that we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Please rise for a reading from the Gospels. Today's gospel reading comes from Luke chapter 12. We begin at verse 35. And again, Jesus is stressing the aspect of being ready, because indeed he will come soon. Jesus says, be dressed, ready for service, and keep your lamps burning. Be like people waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet, so that when he comes and knocks, they can immediately open the door for him. Blessed are those servants whom the master will continue watching when he comes. Amen, I tell you, he will dress himself and have them recline at the table, and he will come and serve them. Even if he comes in the second or third watch, they will be blessed if he finds them alert. But know this, if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. You also be ready, because the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you will not, when you are not expecting him. Here ends our gospel reading.
To you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Service continues now with hymn 529, In the Cross of Christ Thy Glory. We turn now to the words which were our second lesson for today from Revelation chapter 22, verses 6 through 13. I'll just read to you the last two verses once again, where Jesus says, look, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me, to repay each one according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, today, as we give our attention to your words, we pray that you will bless us with your Spirit, that we may understand that your word is always true, and that it is important for us to take it seriously every day. Help us to take it seriously this morning, that we give our full attention to what you have spoken to us through the Apostle John, that we might apply these words to our hearts, that they might be wisdom to us, and they might keep us on that path of watchfulness until you come again in glory. We ask these things in our Savior's name. Amen. When do you take something seriously? Is it not And you know that the words which you have heard are true. I don't know what your experience is on a weekly basis, but it seems as if my email is filled up on a very regular basis with fraudulent emails. In some cases, I supposedly bought something, and if I didn't, I'm supposed to contact them. On the other hand, there is this individual in some far-off country that has millions of dollars, needs to get them into the country. They found out that I'm a very trustworthy person, and they want to use me to get that money into the country, and they promise to give me a good portion of it. The reality is, in both cases, they want to get into my bank account and take what I have. I know they're not true, and so I don't take them seriously. I just hit the delete button. Is that why people are living such riotous lives today? Is it that they don't take Jesus' words that he is coming soon seriously because they do not see it as the truth? Is it because that when Scripture says that God is holy and just and will judge us, they do not see those words as being true? The Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Romans, tells us, "And do this since you understand the present time. It is already the hour for you to wake up from sleep, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is almost over and the day is drawing near. So let us put away the deeds of darkness and put on the weapons of light. Let us walk decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual sin and wild living, not in strife and jealousy. Instead, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not give any thought to satisfying the desires of your sinful flesh." When you look at these words in their context, you will note that the Apostle Paul repeatedly reminds his readers that Jesus is coming to judge, that God will judge the living and the dead. Why do people not take this seriously? Why do people who are raised in the Christian church, who have been taught all the wonderful truths of the basic doctrines of Scripture, why do they not take these words seriously and remain faithful to what they've been taught? It's simple. They do not consider these words to be true. On this last day of the church year, we think about the fact that there will be a last day for this world in its present form, a last day for us in our present form. And whereas the coming of Christ is completely unknown to us, and by that I mean when exactly he is going to come, we do know that Jesus has announced to us repeatedly, he is coming soon. Now, as John closes out this book of Revelation and closes out Scripture as a whole, he gives us very good reason to take to heart the content not only of this book, but the content of all of Scripture. We are to take these words seriously because, you see, the words contained in Scripture are true. For this reason, we close another church year with this reminder. Embrace every word of Jesus. John has witnessed in this book of Revelation 7 different visions. And as he is getting near to completing this record of what he has not only seen but what he has heard, he says, "The angel said to me, these words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place." These words actually echo the first words that John wrote at the beginning of the book of Revelation. The very first verse reads this way: the revelation from Jesus Christ that God gave to show His servants the things that must soon take place. To whom do these words in the book of Revelation belong? To whom do the words in all of Scripture belong? They belong to Jesus. And so what that tells us is that the things that are found in Scripture, what are found here in the book of Revelation, belong to the one who is of divine origin. Jesus is the one from whom these words came. He is the true God from all eternity. Note what he says at the end of our text. In the 13th verse, he identifies himself as the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. In other words, he's eternal. He is changeless. He is the I Am. You know, Lord in the Old Testament, in all caps, Adonai. The one who was and who is and who always will be. The angel testifies to the certainty of his message. He says his words are faithful and sure. That expression is used four times in this book. Two times they are applied to Jesus as the one who is faithful and sure. It is applied twice as well to the attributes that are ascribed to the words that are written in this book. This calls to our attention the close relationship between what we find in Scripture and Christ. Christ, who is what? As John says in the opening chapter of his gospel, he's the Word who becomes flesh. He is the words of Scripture that come alive in the person Jesus Christ. The words of the Bible, because then they belong to God, have all the attributes of God. They are faithful. They are true. You see, God always keeps the promises that He makes to us. Listen to what Scripture says about God and His faithfulness. In Numbers, we are told God is not a man that He should lie, nor a son of man that He changes His mind. Does He say something and not carry it out? Obviously not. Does He speak and then not bring it about? Certainly not. The psalmist writes, "The fear of the Lord is pure, it stands forever. The just decrees of the Lord are what? They are truth. They are altogether righteous. They are more desirable than gold, even better than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, even honey dripping from the honeycomb. Yes, by them your servant is what? Your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great what? Great reward." And the Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Romans, in speaking about Abraham, remember that situation when Abraham was without a child and God said, "You are going to be the father of many nations." Paul says Abraham was fully convinced that God was able to do what He had promised. In fact, Abraham was so convinced of God's promises to him that He would make him the father of many nations, that when He instructed him to slay, to sacrifice his only son that was the key to him becoming the father of many nations, he believed that if God allowed him to go through with it, He would raise his son from the dead. The words of Jesus are not something that we are to be giving a casual glance to. Peter testified to Jesus what? "You have the words of eternal life. You alone have the words of eternal life. You're not going to find eternal life anywhere else." So that as Paul began his letter to the Romans and he's speaking about the gospel, he says it's only this gospel that is the power of God to save us. Up to 7 o'clock this morning, since last Tuesday, our lives have been filled with nothing but weather alerts, right? And it's interesting, as soon as those weather alerts come out, you can see the anxiousness of people. People trying to prepare for the worst. Why? Well, they take these weather alerts seriously. Jesus says to us, "And look, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who holds on to the words of the prophecy of this book." If we take these weather alerts seriously, how much more should we not take seriously this alert? He's coming, and he's coming soon. There is a sense of urgency here in Jesus' words. We're not to delay. We are not to give him our divided attention, be looking elsewhere. It should be undivided attention. We need to be making ready for his coming. Now again, we don't know the exact day and the hour, month, or year when he is going to come. But we do know that we dare not mock him, in that since it's been 2,000 years since he said this to us, that we should not then take him seriously. I ask you, does he speak and then not fulfill what he has told us? You know, I said, I think it was in Bible class this past Wednesday evening. You know, you look at the Old Testament. How long does it take from the moment God says to Satan, I'm going to send a descendant of the woman who is going to do battle with you and crush your head, to God actually fulfilling that? It's about 4,000 years. We're only halfway to 4,000. Let's not get lazy. Let's not think he's not coming. Let's not mock him as people were already doing in the first century, as Peter tells us. As we saw last Sunday, his coming is going to be, first of all, a day of great terror for those who have not been faithful to this word, who have not held on to it. But in the same breath, what did we hear last week? It is going to be a day of what? It's going to be a day of healing, a day of salvation. This is a day of blessing. And when you over here see this word blessed, always think of the word happy, because that's really what that word means. Happy. This blessing results in happiness. And it'll result in happiness for everyone who has taken seriously all the things that have been written in this book and have held on to them faithfully. He's going to bring to us everything that he has promised in this book, and more so. Consider the things that he has said previously in chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation as he writes to the churches. In chapter 2, verse 7, he says, to the one who is victorious, I will give the privilege to eat from what? The tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. What does that mean? We're going to eat from the tree of life? We're never going to die. Chapter 2, verse 10. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. In the same chapter, verse 17, I will also give him a white stone with a new name written on it, which no one will know except the one who receives it. A new name, a name God gives to us, that he ascribes to us, a name that will not be taken from us. In verse 26, to the one who is victorious and continues to do my works until the end, I will give him authority over the nations. We will rule with him. Chapter 3, verse 5, I certainly will not erase his name from the book of life. We can't be taken out of there. Chapter 3, verse 12, I will also write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem which is coming down out of heaven from my God, and my new name. We are his. We have been stamped with his name. So that then again we will have the right and privilege in verse 21. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne. As we noted last week, we will rule with him for all eternity. We will be on the side of the victorious one. We will be victors for all eternity. You know, you go back to our Old Testament reading. What was Habakkuk's problem? A thing we noted last week. Injustice. There's so much injustice. Where are you, God? Why don't you do something? Here's where the justice will be carried out. Jesus leaves no doubt in this book how we alone can stand on that day when he comes and judges the living and the dead. Scripture, first of all, makes it very clear to us that if we wish to stand on that day all alone before God, we will not stand. We stand before God condemned. Why? Because of our sinfulness. The prophet Isaiah said, all of us have become like something unclean, and all our righteous acts are like a filthy cloth. What Isaiah is stressing here is, you know the things that you think are pretty good in your life? The things that God ought to smile on you for? The things that ought to get you brownie points with him and enable you to get off the hook when you walk into the courtroom of God? They're like a filthy rag. They're worthless. So that Paul would write of all of us, in fact, there is no difference. Why? Because all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. How many people are perfect? Not one. Not one person is worthy of the kingdom of God. But wait a minute. In this book of Revelation, we are told repeatedly, a lamb has been slain. In the book of Genesis, when you go back to chapter 3, and what's in chapter 3? Chapter 3 is where everything unravels, where Adam and Eve fall into sin. What's the first thing Adam and Eve do after they have sinned? They suddenly realize they don't have any clothing. They recognize their nakedness. And so they sew together fig leaves to try to cover themselves, to try to make themselves presentable in the presence of God. In the 21st verse of that chapter, Moses tells us, the Lord God made clothing of animal skins for Adam and for his wife and clothed them. Was their clothing sufficient? No, it was not. Their clothing was going to have to come from God. What did he give them? The skin of an animal. What would this require? Killing an animal. Shedding the blood of an animal. This foreshadowed the fact that any effort made on the part of humanity to try to make themselves presentable in the sight of God would fail. In order for humanity to be able to stand in the presence of God, it was going to require the shedding of blood and not an animal. No, one who is pictured as the Lamb of God. John writes in the verse after our text, blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life, so that they may enter through the gates into the city. Who's going to be able to enter into the kingdom of God? Who will be declared not guilty on the last day in the presence of God? Those who've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, namely Jesus Christ. We will hear in the Advent season again, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the testimony of John the Baptist. Here's the lamb that God provided. All the lambs that were slain in the past were only pictures of what he would do. And that blood is shed at Calvary. Holy blood, precious blood, the only blood that can cleanse you and me from our sins. Only those who are found washed in this blood will be able to stand on the last day. For when Jesus comes, everything in this world will come to a standstill. There's not going to be any more time for last-minute preparations. You know, it's not going to be like if you're hosting in the holidays some meal and the guests arrive a little early and somebody informs you, hey, they're here ready. And you're scurrying around trying to do the last-minute things. No, when he's coming and you see him coming, there's not going to be any scurrying around to try to change anything. John writes in our text, the angel said to me, do not seal up the words of this prophecy of this book, because the time is near. Let the one who is unjust continue to be unjust. Let the one who is filthy continue to be filthy. Let the one who is just continue to do what is just, and let the one who is holy continue to be holy. What the angel is saying is this, when he comes, the one who is unjust, the one who is ungodly, the one who rejected the gospel, you're going to stay in that state for the rest of eternity. The opportunity for change, the opportunity for repentance is no longer present. But the one who repented, the one who was found in Christ, such an individual will remain with Christ in eternity. Nothing will change for them as well. You think then that it would be wise for us to heed the words of Jesus when he says in our text, look, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me to repay each one according to what he has done. Has the Christian community become lazy and drowsy? Have we forgotten our first love? Next Sunday, we started all over again. with a new church year. And in that first half of the church year, we will trace out again the wonderful grace of our God as He demonstrated His love for us in His Son, Jesus Christ. In those first four Sundays, in the season of Advent, yes, we are reminded He came the first time, but more importantly, we are again reminded He is coming again. And all these preparations we make to get ready for the celebration of Christmas, even more so, we need to be preparing for that time when He will appear in all the clouds, in all of His glory, with all of His angels. So I urge you, join me in embracing the gracious words of our Savior as we look forward to this new church year. May you and I take seriously what He says. May we embrace every word that He speaks to us, not glance over it. May God the Holy Spirit enable us to remember these words and apply them to our lives to the glory of His name and for our salvation and the security that we so desperately seek. We close our study this morning with the thoughts of the hymnist who wrote, O Lord, how shall we meet You? How welcome You aright. Your people long to greet You, my hope, my heart's delight. O Jesus, let Your word be a lamp to light my way, to show me how to please You, to guide me every day. Amen. Please rise. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join now in making confession of our Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, on this last Sunday of the church year, we want to thank You for all the opportunities we've had over this church year to be fed through the gospel in both word and sacrament. This is a gift given to us by You, the opportunity to worship, to gather, to study Your word. Help us to be mindful of the importance of this word. Help us to hold on to these words in the way that they have been presented to us in the scriptures. Your Son made it very clear to us that in the last days there would be so many who would despise these words. Individuals who profess to represent You faithfully, leaders of the church who are leading God's people not closer to You but farther away. Dear Heavenly Father, help us to remain faithful to these words. Help us to see everything that You tell us in the Scriptures as the truth. Help us to apply these words to our lives, that we live them in a way that it demonstrates to the world that we reject the sinfulness and the chaos that we see all around us, and that our guide in our lives, our hope in our lives, our security in our lives are the wonderful promises You have made to us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. How will people know about these things if we do not tell them? And as we think about the opportunities that we will have in the new church here, we pray that first of all You would make us diligent in worship, take opportunities for additional study that is offered here in our congregation, to spend time in your word in our homes, so that we may be equipped by the power, by the Holy Spirit, to share your message with the world. Help us never to be discouraged in this witnessing, but be reminded that it is our responsibility to share this message, and what people do with it, well, that falls on them. Bless us as we ask these things in our Savior's name, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen, amen, amen.
Please be seated. We close today's service with hymn 874, Preserve Your Word, O Savior. Once again, good morning and welcome to everyone. A couple of things. First of all, our next edition of The Forward in Christ did arrive this past week, but unfortunately we were shorted 9 issues. So I've already contacted Northwestern Publishing House, and we should be receiving them this week. So if you didn't get your copy, it will be coming this week. Look for it next Sunday. Again, consider the weather already, as we've been experiencing. If we should get into a situation, I guess if we were living in Western New York, we might have had to call off today with 70-some inches of snow. But we're putting together a list. We want to make sure that we have the right contact information so that we can send out a group text to announce if there are closures and also reminders of special services. We probably have your information, but we want to make sure it's accurate. So there's a sheet in the back of the church, and the sooner that you could give your attention to it, the better, so that we can get that all in place. A reminder that this week, Wednesday evening at 6:30, we will hold our Thanksgiving Eve worship service, and we hope and pray that you will be able to be in attendance. Again, a reminder about the meditations. The latest edition is available to you. It'll take effect at the end of this month. We will be holding our annual Christmas dinner on the 11th of December. Cost is $15. Next Sunday will be the last Sunday. We hope and pray that you'll be a part of this. It's just a great encouragement all around to everybody. The more people we can have involved. So please, if you haven't been a part of it, please accept our invitation to come. Youth reminded of the gathering tonight at Michigan Lutheran High School. Also, the invitation to be a part of the Living Nativity at Grace in St. Joe on the 17th and 18th of December. A new item is the Ladies of South Haven have invited our ladies to participate in the Advent by Candlelight on December 4th. That is in your bulletin. Also, last week in the bulletin was the adopting a family, as we did last year. Elizabeth wanted me to pass along to you that one detail that wasn't able to get in the bulletin is that she would like the gifts for those families, the items for those families, to be here by December 11th. Connected with the two concerts that are in your bulletin this morning is the Chili Supper that will benefit the senior class at Michigan Lutheran High School, so take note of that. The acknowledgement for our gift for the hurricane victims is also in your bulletin today as well. So God bless your week. Drive safely today, and pray we'll see you this Wednesday evening, and well, certainly next Sunday as well. Thank you. Thank you.